Hi, everyone. Are you going to do this every time I say hello? It's wonderful to be here among you. You know Devendra. Politicians usually don't like to meet me. The last time, about 4 or 5 months before the general elections, I went to Delhi and I met a politician. And I interviewed him, and I have not met him after that. I'm happy to meet him. I don't know if he's happy to meet me. Devendra, you're the first person who has wanted to meet me from your fraternity. And let me thank you for that. I hope we'll remain friends at the end of this. In any case, you see, I've not been on TV for about a month, as you may know. We'll be back. We'll be back with Republic very soon. So you've given me a mic and you asked me to speak to Devendra Fadnavis, so you must have the time limit on, because when I'm on TV, there is no time limit. So we'll stop when they tell us to stop. Yeah. Is my show? Yeah. I met Devendra Fadnavis for the first time before a bunch of 5,000 students in the Indian Student Parliament near Pune at MIT, if you remember. It was fantastic. 5 years back. And I was speaking in English and he was speaking in Marathi and Hindi. I was speaking in English and Hindi. And I looked around and I told myself that who is this man? I've never met him before. But he was speaking so passionately. And at that point of time, not everybody knew who Devendra Fadnavis was. Just 4 or 5 years back. And I said, who is this man? It seems he has something special in him. And Devendra, I don't flatter politicians. I don't want to flatter you. But you spoke damn well that day. Damn well. So wherever you've come and wherever you've reached today and all these students are here, you know, you fully deserve it. And it's great to talk to you today, Devendra.
Thank you so much.
I'll have 4 or 5 questions. Then I think we'll open it up, if it's okay. I've spoken to Devendra. Devendra, do we have a deal on that? We can open it up, right?
Absolutely, we can.
We can open it
up. No problem.
Okay. You asked for it.
I think I'll be relieved once we open up.
Question number one, Devendra. What is the difference between freedom, right of expression, and offense? And the reason I'm asking you this is because generally politicians take offense very quickly. A few months back, there was a drought in Maharashtra. You were fighting to handle the situation. And all that politicians were concerned about was a comedian putting out a video on Snapchat. And I asked on my program, what is more important, drought or Snapchat? And it was so bad that I think Tanmay Bhatt had to almost go into hiding for 15 to 20 days. In that context, my very specific question to you, Mr. Fadnavis, and please don't dodge it at all, what is the difference between freedom and offense?
You will never allow me to dodge it, so I'll try to attempt. freedom is absolute. But on the other hand, it's not absolute. Why? Because when we talk of liberty, my liberty is absolute till it doesn't encroaches the liberty of other person. So there is always a limit to a liberty. So I think there is a freedom to everybody, there is a freedom of expression, but freedom of expression till it doesn't encroach the freedom of expression of someone else, it is absolute. I think till it doesn't encroach, it's no offense. Once it encroaches, even constitution thinks that it's an offense.
Who decides?
You decide, me decide, whosoever decide. And when it becomes legal, the constitution decides.
But who decided for Tanmay Bhatt? The poor guy got scared.
See, about Tanmay Bhatt, my opinion is that, it's a private program. So, I think in privacy, he has all freedom. Once it comes into public domain, you have all laws of your land. If it violates law of your land, then somebody has to decide that whether it violates or not. You have courts, you have prosecution, they will decide.
What people want to know, what these students want to know, what the nation wants to know, and what the republic wants to know, Mr. Fadnavis, where will you stand between a person who's being attacked and a person who's being oversensitive? Which side will you stand on, Mr. Fadnavis?
I'll stand by constitution, because I've taken oath to stand by constitution. So whatever constitution says, I have to stand by.
I think they're enjoying this, Mr. Fadnavis. I hope you have enough time. I will now pull out a few questions for you since you're enjoying it. Why do politicians love vote banks? I have often seen that you put what is right and wrong before a politician, and you put a vote bank on the other side. What is right and wrong will not matter to a politician, but a vote bank will matter to a politician. And let me explain. I believe in social change, Mr. Fadnavis, and so do you. When we fought for the right to pray for women in this country, we fought alone. When we said women should be allowed to enter places of worship and pray with men on an equal footing, I felt we fought alone. When we said that in Sabarimalai, women should be allowed equal access, we fought alone. When we said that Haji Ali, outside the Dargah, women stand saying give us equal rights, we fought alone. And people often ask me, why do you shout? And I say, you have to shout to be heard in this country. And we shouted and shouted and shouted, Devendra, you know this. And then politicians sort of followed, and then the courts also followed. Which makes me ask you, why don't politicians take the first big step towards big social change in this country? Why do they follow the media and follow the judiciary all the time?
You see, answer to your first question, why do politicians love vote bank? The answer would be the same. Why does Arnav love television? The same answer.
You love television,
so we love the vote banks. Because, you know, you want me to be an agent of change. I can be agent of change only if I am elected. If I am defeated, I cannot be. So I have to strike a balance between vote bank politics and what is socially, morally correct. So on one hand, I have to take care of my vote bank, because unless I take care of it, I'll never get elected. But on the other hand, I must know my limits. And from when it comes to morality, when it comes to social change, I have to pursue an agenda. So far as Sabrimala or Haji Ali or Shani Shingnapur is concerned, my government took a firm decision. So even at Shani Shingnapur, we managed the women to go to the Sanctum Sanctorium. They climbed that particular area, and finally, even the trustees agreed. Even in the case of Haji Ali, in the court, my government took a position that we don't think that discriminating women is integral part of Islam. So it doesn't violate any religious right. And I don't think that any of the religion will ever discriminate women from worshipping. I think no God will say that women do not come. And when, at least in Hinduism, when there are so many goddesses whom we worship and we feel that, we get inspiration from them. So I think this discrimination is absolutely not done, and we have stood by it. So see, government in all such cases have taken a very clear-cut position in the court that we are against discrimination. We feel that women have equal rights.
I'm not convinced.
It's difficult to convince you.
The reason is, Devendra, you have to choose between right and wrong. I bring you back to the original question.
See, Arnav, let me tell you one thing.
You can
go on television and you can shout, because you don't have to ask for votes. You don't go for election every 5 years, so you can say anything. I have to go to people for every 5 years, and you know, ultimately those people elect me. So on one hand, I have to shape their opinions, but on other hand, I also have to value their opinions.
In 2011, I met a person called Manmohan Singh in a press conference. Which, by the way, Devendra, was itself breaking news that Manmohan Singh was speaking. And I asked him a question. I said, Mr. Manmohan Singh, Dr. Manmohan Singh, I asked him about the scams, and he answered with the famous phrase, compulsions of coalition politics. And I said, Dr. Manmohan Singh, Mr. Prime Minister, you have to have, I understand what you're saying, but you can't compromise on corruption. The moot point was on a choice between right and wrong. When something is wrong, it doesn't matter if you have a vote bank with it. You must stand up to it. And sometimes you may have to do things that are unpopular. You would know that for yourself, your own central government has taken a calculated political risk on the issue of demonetization. That may not be popular, but it's being done because the government has the conviction that it's good in the long term. So I don't know how you can be guided. So my same point is, that's on an economic agenda. I want to know that whether if on an economic agenda you can take a stance, then why wouldn't a young political leader like you take a very strong stance on a social agenda, saying, I'll bite the bullet, it may not work for me, I'll take a risk, I'll offend someone, but if it's correct, I'll back what is right.
That's what I'm doing. That's what position I took on Shani Shingnapur. That's what position I took on Haji Ali. So we have been taking, you know, my language may not be as strong as yours, because I'm a soft person. I'm not as fiery as you.
Mr. Fadnavis, what makes you feel I'm not a soft person?
Nation knows.
And I've heard this very often, you see, when the politician eventually answers questions saying, what do you know? I go among the people. I get voted. You go on TV. That's all right. People watching me on TV are also human beings, and thank God I don't ask for votes, Mr. Patnaik. My next question to you is this. When we were in college, we came in college in the aftermath of the Mandal Commission agitation, and take a position on this. We were told reservations will end in a fixed period of time. The founding fathers of this country also said merit must matter. Only merit. Not merit and anything else. And I say this before this audience in the context of my own personal experience, if you allow me, I'll share with you. That when we entered college, we studied very hard. Mr. Fadnavis, I studied in Kendriya Vidyalaya, Jabalpur. And I worked hard. When I got my class 12 marks, at that time 88%, I said, damn good. And we went to college and we stood in a line. And we chose the course. And when we entered the course in the right college, we felt very proud. But when we entered the college, the first time people said, oh, don't go to college. And I remember I asked why. They said, because the campus is burning. I was in Delhi University, Mr. Fadnavis, Hindu College. Campus was burning. Campus was burning in the aftermath of the Mandal Commission agitation. And that's when they said to me, you are not your marks, you are not your course, you are not your college, you are only your caste. And they told me, don't enter college because you are Goswami. You are not this course, this college, this percentage. In that context, I'm asking you, because what happened, Mandal and Babri, which happened during our times in college, left a mark on us. And many people from our generation left India, and many didn't come back. To enthuse this audience about the future of merit in our country, would you say that at some point, the politics of caste, I'm not against affirmative action, but the politics of caste and around caste, for young India, at some point of time must stop, and only merit should prevail.
I think there are two situations. One is about the policy of reservation. Now, do we need it? So my opinion is, yes, we need it. Why? Because there has been a lot of deprivation. And what is the rationale for the policy is those who have been socially, educationally, culturally, and economically backward on all four counts. See, we have agreed for equality of opportunity. And equality of opportunity will never be attended if we want somebody to compete with somebody who is socially forward, who is economically forward, who is educationally forward, who is culturally forward. Ultimately, a person who has certain social backgrounds, who has gone through certain traumatic times, I think he needs a level playing field. So I think the policy per se of reservation is correct. I stand by it. But at the same time, things are changing. You know, if you look at now All India exams, the difference between open and OBC is now just 1%. So things are changing. And once, you know, the merit of an open and OBC match, or after some time, merit of an open OBC scheduled caste and scheduled tribe match, nobody will ask for reservation. So I think things are changing. I know that those people, especially those students who don't get admission, and somebody with a lower ranking gets admission, it's quite traumatic for the student. But ultimately, it's not because of only the policy of reservation. It's because we could not expand our educational institutions to create so many seats that everybody is accommodated. So I think expansion is a solution on that. Excellence is a solution on that. Because, you know, we have very few IITs. But why can't we bring other our institutions to the level of, you know, excellence, to the level of IITs? That is a solution. The solution is not cutting down on reservation for next few years at least. The solution is to expand the education, and I think once we expand it, once we excel, and once this matching of percentages start, I think those who are from the reserved caste, they will say that we don't require any reservation now.
This. This new angle you've presented about the matching of marks is a new formula. I've never heard of it before. you could be shifting the goalpost. Now, question is, where do we stop? And I love talking about contentious issues. And so I pick up the contentious. At what point do we stop? You see, reservations in private sector, people are saying. Corporate sector. You know, so some point somebody is going to tell you that at what point do you say that you're encouraging people to come at, you know, at equal opportunities? At one point of time do you make it a disincentive for others? I've debated this issue of reservations in private sector also, Mr. Fadnavis. That becomes a contentious issue. I've even recently heard about reservations for judiciary being talked about and supported by some people. Are we taking it too far?
So far as I know, there's no proposal of any reservations in private sector. Long time it has been debated, and unanimously, almost all parties and all stakeholders have decided that private sector, there will be no reservation. So I think there's no such proposal at all. So far as judiciary is concerned, I think judiciary has its own capacity, to accommodate people. But having said that, the fact is that after Mr. Balakrishnan, there has not been a single scheduled caste judge in the Supreme Court. That is also an area of concern. Now that if you look at,
Are you saying that the collegium is biased?
See, I cannot say that. If I say that, it would amount to, contempt. But I think somewhere you have to look into it, because I don't think that there is not a single scheduled caste competent judge in entire country who can be a Supreme Court judge. For last 8 years, we don't have a single scheduled caste judge in the Supreme Court. That doesn't represent, the entire social strata of the country. So we have to look into it. So we don't require reservation there, but we need to look at the policies. Are they biased? Are they not allowing somebody to graduate to Supreme Court? That is a question that nation wants to know.
I think we should open up to some questions from the audience. Should we? One more to him and then I pass it on.
I hope you will be kind to me, unlike Arnab.
The one thing I don't like is the concept of dynasty. Whose son or daughter are you? A matter of right, a sense of entitlement. I hate it, Devendra. I can't stand it. Unfortunately, even in the business where we have come in the media, there have been dynasties, and I'm trying to break that with Republic. I want to know from you how easy or difficult it is to end the concept of dynasty in politics.
In politics, ultimately, people choose their representatives. Having said that, I think it should not be a disqualification to be a son or daughter
of
a politician.
But
it should not be the sole qualification. When people with social background,
for Rahul Gandhi, is it the sole qualification?
I think
the same concept would apply
yes.
for Rahul Gandhi.
I think yes.
What?
The sole qualification for Mr. Rahul Gandhi has been that he belongs to Gandhi Nehru family. That's the only qualification.
Should we throw open?
Yeah, please.
Are you ready? We're ready.
Absolutely.
We're ready when we are
game. And let me tell you, you can ask some questions to Arnab as well.
Okay, we'll throw open the questions. Do you have a mic?
Yeah.
Are we putting a mic across to the audience? Would you like to ask some questions to any of us? Well, that's a lot of people there. I actually couldn't make out how many people were in the audience. I'm telling you, Devendra, we are sitting here as the entertainment for thousands of people this afternoon. And there must be some reason why they are not in class and they are not out there and they're not listening to the music. It's great. Great. Okay, someone's got to moderate this because I can't choose between so many hands. So I think someone's got to decide, or do I decide that? Okay, come on, sir. Sir, you want to take...
Yeah. Someone take the mic over there.
Someone come up. Because I suggest someone come up. If you're going to help, pass the mic around, you can tell them from here. Someone's got to come up.
Sir, this is Yash Lahoti from Pune.
So who is your question to where you got to ask that?
Devendra, sir. Sir, two months back, we had a IEEE Congress, which is a global event in Bangalore. Our university exams were first scheduled in the second week of August. But due to some problem, which was not told, the GR came and the exams got shifted 2 weeks later. So we had thrown an application because the Congress was at the same time and the university has certain rules under which an exam for some special students who are attending some global events can be taken. So we had thrown an application to the vice chancellor of the university, but there was no reply from him for a week. Later on, we moved to the university. We had a talk with all the officer on special duty, controller of examination and everybody. But there was no response.
I understood your question. You see, basically, what I really feel is that we need to give autonomy to our colleges. You know, the university like Mumbai, university like Pune, university like Nagpur, it has 500,000 affiliated colleges. And with 500 or 1,000 affiliated colleges, no university can excel. So now the policy of our government is to give maximum autonomy to the colleges so that they are governed independently. At the same time, we have a proper accreditation procedure in place so that the excellence in education is also guaranteed. I think at the first instance, since you are from Pune, which college are you from? Okay, so COEP Pune, we are giving the autonomy very soon, and we want all such colleges to be autonomous, to have all flexibility, to have to decide their own curriculum, and I think that will solve your problem.
Hello sir, my name is Namita Saval. I'm a master's student here at IIT Bombay. So this is regarding the 1,000 villages mission. So there is this drive from you that you want 1,000 villages to be transformed in Maharashtra, and there is a plan for it. There is a fellowship program as well. So you're offering, people to join this fellowship and you're giving them 35,000 rupees and expect them to do competent jobs. Especially being in IIT, I think there's a stigma, because IITs eventually flock to US and Europe and places like that. And that is what we face through. Isn't it time that government offer competent jobs to, students, especially like IIT Bombay and other universities, so that we can merge the development sector with appropriate compensation?
Great, I offer you a job up front. Please join the government. Let me tell you, my secretary, Milind Mehskar, is here, who is secretary to government of Maharashtra, and he is from IIT Mumbai.
Yes, sir.
I think you make a point. We require the best of the brains, and I think there are a lot of IITians who would like to enter into government. We'll create a window for them.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I'm always willing to work for the society, making an impact for the society. But I find it can be done in two ways, either by becoming a politician or by becoming a bureaucrat. So my question is, why doesn't the government of Maharashtra come on the first day of placements at our campus IIT Bombay for hiring us? Sir, even if the pay is low, I find like many people would like to work in the government or as a bureaucrat rather than working in many MNCs.
Great, that's a... I think that's very encouraging. We would really love to come here for, to recruit you. We'll be happy.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Kaustubh, and I read about politics. Also, I have met some of the ground level workers. After getting admission in IIT, most of us think that it's a good time to relax. And similarly, you are also at the top position. So do you feel the same complacency?
Can you see the black spots below my eyes? I've not slept for last 2 years. You know, I'm with such a job that I cannot be complacent. You know, every passing day takes away my sleep because I have miles to go. I have so many things to achieve. I've started so many projects. I have to transform. I don't think that ever there will be any complacency in my case.
Hello, sir. So since Mr. Arnab's here too, I figured I'd ask this question to the both of you. Would you say that today the boundaries between journalism, politics, and business have almost disappeared? If yes, then is this good for the Indian democracy? And how do you suggest that we cope with this?
I believe there must be very hard walls between journalism, businessmen, and politics. And I think this is only possible. It's only possible when journalists take over the media. And our experiment, you ask, what are we doing? Republic is India's first, completely, in this century, journalists run, journalists owned, journalists managed media in this country. And we are taking a step in that direction. And in this world today where everyone says that only money can win you the hearts of the consumers and the viewers, we are out there as a revolution in news to make sure and to prove a point that eventually nobody can take us away from our readers and our consumers. So we are breaking this whole boundary that has been created between corporate-owned media. We are India's first truly independent media, and I hope we have the support of people like you. Thank you.
Hello, sir. This is Shitesh Vadwani. I want to ask both of you, like, is the demonetization answer to the corruption which currently the Modi government has taken? Like, it has become a like business. Like, most of people are selling their notes in at a percentage to people. I have seen it. Like, and what about the Swiss bank issue? Like, it's not being taken out to the public. What's happening to the money going there?
So maybe I'll answer first. See, demonetization is one of the steps towards eliminating corruption. It's not the ultimate step. It's one of the steps. And see, now when 13 lakh crores have come to the banks, this was the money whose address we never knew. Its footprint we never knew. Now this 13 lakh crores, once they have entered into the banks, we know from where have they come, whether tax is paid or not. So I think the first success of demonetization is that money has come to the banks. Now we know the address, we have a footprint. Now we can go back on the trail and find out whether the taxes were paid or not. If they were not paid, then I think we can account for those taxes. Whatever penalties are being levied, those penalties will be levied. So I think largely demonetization has been very successful. Yes, there have been instances where people have tried to change the money. Some people must have also succeeded, but it's a short-term success. The moment, ultimately, whatever money you have changed has to come to bank, and at some point of time after 31st of December, you will have to explain from where has this money come. So those who have tried to exchange money will be in more fix than those who have declared their income. So I don't think that now anybody could be spared. So far as Swiss bank issue is concerned, I think for the first time, you know, in 2004, we became party to the declaration of giving informations about corruption, about banks, bank accounts, where I think 117 nations were signatory. But till 2011, we did not ratify it. It was only after the intervention of Supreme Court that the government of India in 2012 ratified that treaty, where the voluntary disclosure of all the foreign accounts was envisaged. And now with that treaty, I think what Mr. Modi did, he went bilaterally to every single country and he entered into a bilateral agreement with those countries. So this treaty, although it gave us a power to have access to all the accounts, but there were a lot of restrictions, and those restrictions were again protecting the people who have stashed money. Now with this bilateral treaties which Mr. Modi has made in last 2 years, there are no restrictions. And after that, if you look at last 1 year, maximum foreign accounts have been unearthed and maximum foreign money which has been brought back is in last 1 year. So I think, although if we would not have wasted the time from 2004 to 2011, I think we would have got much more. Because when you alert people that such a treaty is signed and you don't act for 8 years, the people who have stashed money are not fools. They will, you know, take away the money to proper destinations. That's what they did. So I think today the entire framework is there to bring back the money from the foreign banks.
Just the last question in this round.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is both to you. You know, in any of the field, there is a need of diplomacy. So you being saying that we are coming with a channel republic that is going to be completely unbiased, and sir, you saying that vote banks and morally and things should be done. So isn't it like there has to be a kind of diplomacy to survive in this country?
Have I done anything in the last 15 years to make you believe I'm a diplomat? As far as I'm concerned, I can never be a diplomat. And I think there are too many diplomats who are disguised as journalists today. Like I believe there are too many politicians disguised as journalists and businessmen disguised as journalists. I also believe there are many diplomats disguised as journalists. I want to just one line respond to the question on the demonetization. I don't know why Arvind Kejriwal opposes demonetization. But Arvind came in much later. We broke the scams, and then he brought his marketing brain to talk about corruption. Arvind Kejriwal and people like him who oppose demonetization should know that Kalmadi and Raja would never have been able to do their business through Paytm. That for me, the greatest single push towards a digital economy we dream of. We dream of a digital economy, and believe me, this digital economy will take this country forward. There is pain, but I know this is one of those steps which 6 months or 1 year from now we're going to look back and say, well done.
Okay, I think that's the end of the Q&A session. Now we'd like to address some questions which people from India have tweeted. There are three questions. The first question is by Rahul, who asked, you are currently one of the youngest chief minister. What are your next ambitions? Do you ever plan to become the prime minister?
Bhaiya, chief minister rehne do. See, let me tell you, in our country, those who have dreamt to become prime minister have never become prime minister. Look at Mr. Sharad Pawar, look at Mr. Mulayam Singh Yadav, look at Mr. Lalu Prasad Yadav. So I am better
placed as a chief minister and happy.
Okay.
Yeah, so, what Arnab says is also right.
Let me add one thing to that, that those who never wanted to become became. I.K. Gujral, we never knew of him, he became Prime Minister. Deve Gowda became Prime Minister. So, now that's a diplomat, huh? That's the diplomat, not me.
Okay, so the second question is from Shitis. He asked, if you would have been an engineering pass out of an IIT, which company would have been your dream company?
The company, Devendra company.
So the last question is from Hemant, who asked, do you think the skill sets needed for excelling in politics and excelling in governance is different?
I think that is the irony, that the skill set to excel in politics and to excel in governance are still quite different. But I think that's what this generation can change. I think the skill sets to become a politician and to be in governance can become same if we start voting sensibly, if we start voting on agenda, on certain points. I think the things will change. So I think this generation has all powers, has all capacity to actually bridge this gap. And once this, because we often say that there are people who are best people to govern, but they never get elected. And there are people who are never defeated and become ministers for many, many years, but do not know whether they have more powers or their secretary has have more powers. So I think this needs to change, and your generation can change it. I think probably this is for the first time that Arnab has spoken less than everybody else. But I think I must say, Arnab, nation doesn't want to know because nation believes on you. And we are sure that the Republic will be people's voice. In fact, when I came here, I was quite worried, a little bit scared, because on one hand, you have best of the brains from the country, and on the other hand, you have one of the most fiery and fearless anchors and editors the Indian media so far had. So I was just hoping that you don't make a Rahul Gandhi out of me. Thank you for sparing me. In fact, this Transform Maharashtra is a platform where we want you to participate. I've often seen that there are skeptical remarks from the earlier generations that, look, our times were better. We did this, we did that, and this new generation does not know what to do, how to do, they have no ethos. But I'm a firm believer that every gen next is better than the earlier generation. They have more exposure, And every generation has its own ethos. I think if we want to transform this country, a country which has a population which is young, which is youthful, a country with 50% of its population below 25 years, how can we transform this country without participation of youth? If we do not know their aspirations, if we do not accommodate their skills, if we do not know where they want to go or where we want to take them, how are we going to transform this country? And I think that is why we have decided that we will have a platform where we will ask everybody to participate. We have enlisted 12 issues ranging from poverty, education, all those major issues which matters for development. And we want people to participate, to come out with innovative ideas. I think I did not tell you about innovation and disruption, but that is a key to development. And I have often seen, when I started this idea of having CM fellows in our government, the first batch which came brought with itself absolutely new and fresh ideas. See, we have IAS officers, we have people in public life for many years, but we have our own ways to look at the problem. But when somebody from the community, somebody new, somebody fresh comes up, he has entire different perspective to look at the problem. And let me tell you, my first batch of CM fellows have contributed immensely towards the development of this state, and they have come out with many innovative solutions. So that has enthused me. I feel that now is a time when we have so many brains who want to contribute. And look here, two students are eager to join government. Normally, for an IITian to join a government had always been, I think, the last idea. But now people want us to... Don't be Kejriwal, bhai. Ek hi kafi hai. We know the nation doesn't need more. We'll cope up with one. But I think we want you, we want all these brains to come together. So with this contest, we want students from 500 different colleges to come out with their innovative ideas on these 12 issues. And I think the best ideas we will choose. And after choosing those best ideas, we'll not only reward those ideas, but I assure you that government will implement the best ideas which we get out of this contest. And I think I'm looking forward for many innovations, for many disruptive ideas which will take a leapfrog and which will take this state, this nation to the next level. I think with my presence in this Mood Indigo, I'm really happy to interact with the youth of this country. And when I interact, I get to know their aspirations. I get to know their way of thinking. And that drives me. That drives me towards right direction. In democracy, many times we live in illusion. We feel that we know everything. We feel that we are there to decide for people. But I think no, democracy is all about participation. You may have different views, I may have different views, we'll fight. I'll disagree with you, you disagree with me. But ultimately, in democracy, the collective wisdom prevails.
And that is the beauty of democracy, that this collective wisdom has brought us to this stage where now our entire country is looked upon as one of the most developing nations in the world. And I must also thank our Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Modi. His innovative ideas, his risk-taking capacity, and his conviction towards his ideas will transform this nation in less than 5 years. And I'm sure with the support like what you have been giving, we can change this nation. So now, let's do first thing. Let's take this nation towards a cashless nation, as rightly said by Arnab. See, if we replace currency through currency, it's of no use. If the entire currency is replaced by currency, it will again generate black money. We need to create footprint of every penny which is spent, and that footprint can be created only, I think, through the digital payment system. And it is beneficial to the last person of the society, to the farmer, because often we have seen that the farmer doesn't get MSP. His produce is bought below MSP, but he cannot complain because there is no footprint. But once the digital payment starts, and if he gets anything below MSP, a police complaint would be lodged, and those who purchase below MSP can be taken to task. A small labor. We have Minimum Wages Act. But are we really paying minimum wages to our labor? No, we are not. Why? Because there is no footprint. Nobody knows what is paid. On the register, you write that we have given 350 rupees a day. And in fact, 100 rupees, 75 rupees, 50 rupees are given. But once we start these payments through digital format, I think no labor will ever get less than minimum wage. So I think this entire system is not for a handful few. For us, we can always manage. We can go to Lakshmi and swipe our card and have our food, right? But what about those people who cannot? So I think the first challenge which every youth of this country who wants to transform this country should accept, that I will try to make this country cashless, and for that I will educate at least 20 people who do not know how to use digital payment systems. I think at this point of time, the patriotism is to stand by the decision of making this country cashless, because once we graduate to that, I think the fight towards corruption will take a final shape. And once we fight the corruption, once we stop the corruption in this country, we wipe out corruption from this country, nobody on the earth can stop India to be the best nation in the entire world. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Maharashtra.